بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأصلي وأسلم على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، نبينا وحبيبنا وقرة أعيننا محمد بن عبد الله، عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. وقال تعالى في كتابه العزيز بعد: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. وقال تعالى أيضا: يا أيها الذين آمنوا إذا نودي للصلاة من يوم الجمعة فاسعوا إلى ذكر الله وذروا البيع، ذلكم خير لكم إن كنتم تعلمون. All praise and thanks be to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is our creator, sustainer, nourisher, protector and curer. May the choicest of his blessings and salutations be upon our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family members, his companions and all those who tread upon his path with utmost sincerity until the day of Qiyamah. O slaves of Allah, first and foremost I admonish myself and then all of y'all who are present here to adopt a life of taqwa, and that is to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to be conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during every single second of our lives if we wish to attain success in this world as well as the hereafter. May Allah the Almighty make us all from the people of taqwa. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, it is incumbent upon us to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the numerous bounties and favors that He has conferred upon us. Allahu Akbar. If we were to try and count these blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as He rightfully says in the noble Quran, وَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا. If you were to try and enumerate the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you would not be able to encompass all of the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We would fail miserably to count the numerous blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you were to look around you, on a daily basis, we see so many of the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala manifesting itself around us. So many of the favors. The other day I was reading that something so insignificant, something so trivial as even looking at your reflection in the mirror. We do this on a daily basis. In the morning when we wake up, whilst we are brushing our teeth, we look at the mirror. When we are getting ready to head for work, we are looking at the mirror. This looking at the mirror and the ability to put right the flaws in our appearance based on our reflection, that is an advanced cognitive ability which our brains execute very beautifully. And scientists say that this ability is exclusive for the human beings. If you look at the animals, if you put a mirror in front of an animal, the animal is going to think of the reflection that it sees in the mirror as another animal. But we, on the other hand, our brains immediately recognize that it is your own reflection in the mirror, and you can use the mirror, in other words your reflection, to put right the flaws in your appearance. This ability alone signifies how great the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. Imam Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, he reports from one of our Salafun al-Salih, our pious predecessors, that if you want to think of how great the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala which have been conferred upon you, if you want to think of how great they are, just close your eyes for a minute. Just close your eyes for a minute and then you would realize how great the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are. For when you close your eyes, everything around you goes dark. Everything goes black. The optics of our eyes are so advanced, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. If we were to take the most modern piece of hardware today, in terms of cameras, however advanced those cameras may be, they need a few seconds to focus on a particular object. But say I'm reading a book and then I look towards an object which is far away from me, I don't even feel my eyes auto-focusing on that object. I don't have to click on anything to focus on any object. I don't have to turn the lens to focus on an object. All of that happens naturally. Allahu Akbar. And when we look at something, say for example, if I were to look at a blazing fire, look at what happens in our brains. Those signals that fire up, those alarm bells that run in my brains telling me that this is something harmful. It is hot and you are not supposed to get close to it. Say if we were numb to those signals, if we did not feel heat or pain, we would walk right into a blazing fire. Or if we were to open the hot water in the tap and if we were not able to understand that this is hot, if those signals were not traveling to our brains soon enough, we would let our hands be under the tap and perhaps our skin and everything would melt away. This is all from the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we were to take planet Earth, if we were a tad bit away from the sun, all of us would freeze to death. We would all become popsicles, basically snowmen. And on the other hand, if planet Earth was a tad bit closer to the sun, we would all be burnt to ashes. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in His infinite wisdom, He has created us and everything around us in the most perfect of manners. But we sadly, being the slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we fail to show gratitude unto our powerful Creator. We fail to show gratitude. And even if we were to remain in sajda, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, if we were to remain in sajda in prostration throughout our lives, we would not be able to render the gratitude that is due towards our Creator, Allahu Akbar. But it is upon us to show us as much as gratitude as possible towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But we are so ungrateful. Let me share with you all a story. A story of a king many moons ago. This king, he had a few dogs, wild dogs, and he had trained these dogs in such a way that if anybody were to disobey his command, let it be from his ministers, his courtiers, anybody, if they were to disobey his command, he would have them flung into the cage where the dogs were kept. And the dogs were so wild and they were trained in such a way, they used to rip the individual into shreds and perhaps even eat him alive. So one day, there was a minister who advised the king on a particular subject, and his counsel that day, he was unlucky perhaps, his counsel was wrong. And the king ordered that the minister be thrown into the cage with the dogs. The minister cried out, "Oh my king, I have been serving you," or in other words, "I have served you for around 10 years. Please have mercy on me and forgive me for what I did wrong." The king was stubborn and he said, "There is no forgiveness for you and you are to be flung into the cage with the dogs." Then the man, the minister, says, "Oh my king, I served you for 10 years. So can I have one final request?" So the king says, "Sure, what is it?" The minister says, "Can I have 10 days respite? 10 days of time for me to prepare things at home and all of that, and I'll come and then you can throw me into the cage with the dogs." The king grants him his request. The minister The minute he got that 10 days time, he rushes to the keeper of the dogs and he goes and tells him, "Can I look after these dogs for 10 days? Can I look after these dogs for 10 days?" The doorkeeper, he says, "You've got 10 days more to live and you want to look after dogs for your last 10 days? Why don't you go spend it with your family and your loved ones?" The minister says, "No, I'll explain later. I want to look after the dogs for 10 days." He says, "Fine, if that's your last wish, go ahead. Go look after the dogs." This minister, he looks after the dogs. He feeds them. He washes them, bathes them, looks after them. He even sleeps with them. He practically lives with the dogs for 10 days. And on the 11th day, he goes to the king and submits himself. The king orders that he be thrown into the cage with the dogs. The minute he was thrown into the cage, all of those dogs, instead of ripping him into shreds, all of those dogs run up to him and start licking him fondly and start grazing around him and etc. The king was surprised. He cries out, "What kind of magic have you done to my dogs? My highly trained dogs, what have you done to them?" The minister, very beautifully, in a very calm voice, he says, "My beloved king, I served you for 10 years and you throw me into the cage with the dogs. But I served these dogs for just 10 days and they refuse to rip me into shreds. This is their gratitude towards me, but where is your gratitude, O king?" The king, you know, his head was hanging low in shame, and he immediately orders for the pardon of that minister, and the minister was released. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, we are wallowing in an ocean of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are enjoying the benefits, the virtues, the ni'mat, the bounties of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed upon us. But how ungrateful are we towards our powerful, our beloved Creator, and how much we need to think of turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but instead we keep running away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah the Almighty fill our hearts with true love towards our Creator. Now, from these blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes about a beautiful blessing. Allah the Almighty has not created all of time equal, nor has He created all of the places on earth equal, nor has He created mankind equal. Allah the Almighty, out of His infinite wisdom, He has created the months in such a way that the month of Ramadan is the best month from all months. In terms of days, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given priority and preference to Friday over all other days when you talk about the days of a week. And in terms of days in totality, the day of Arafah is given preference. If you talk about places, Makkatul Mukarramah is given preference. And when you talk about mankind, Allah the Almighty has blessed our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to be the best man ever. Allahu Akbar. This is from the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And now comes about the title for today's khutbah, and that is, thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that it is Friday. Thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that it is Friday. Hadith narrated by Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu says, Qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, Khayru yawmin tala'at alayhi shamsu yawmul jum'ah. The best of days upon which the sun has risen is Friday. The best of days upon which the sun has risen is Friday. Fihi khuliqa Adam. On that day, on Friday, Adam alayhi salatu wasalam was created. Wafihi udkhil al-jannah. And on that day, on Friday, he was admitted entry into Jannah, into paradise. Wafihi ukhrija minha. And it was on Friday that Adam alayhi salatu wasalam was taken out of Jannah and sent to the face of this earth. A question may arise that how can the expulsion of Adam alayhi salatu wasalam from Jannah be a significant event to contribute to the virtue of Friday? Well, scholars write, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, that it is through that expulsion where Adam alayhi salatu wasalam was sent to the face of this earth that so many anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam came about. We are on this earth, we are in a test by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of Adam alayhi salatu wasalam coming to the face of this earth. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam was sent to this earth because of that event, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. So definitely it contributes to the significance and the virtue of Friday. In another narration, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam is reported to have said that Friday is the Eid of the week. Friday is considered an Eid, a day of celebration from the whole week. Hadith is in Ibn Majah. Abu Lubaba radiallahu anhu narrates that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam is reported to have said, Friday is the best and greatest of days before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Friday is the greatest and the best of days before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam goes on to say along the lines of these words, and it is even greater than Eid al-Adha, it is even greater than Eid al-Fitr. Friday, Allahu Akbar. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam goes on to say, and Friday has five characteristics, five special characteristics. Number one, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam alayhi salatu wa sallam on a Friday. Number two, Adam alayhi salatu wa sallam was sent to the face of this earth on a Friday. Number three, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala caused Adam alayhi salatu wa sallam to die on a Friday. Number four, on Fridays, there is a special hour. There is a special hour. In that hour, if any one of us were to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala something, that dua would definitely be answered by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as long as that slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not ask for something that is haram, something that is prohibited in Islam. Other than that, if his dua were to coincide with that special hour, his dua is definitely going to be answered. And the final special characteristic mentioned in that particular hadith is that on Friday will occur the day of judgment. Allahu Akbar. The day of judgment will take place on a Friday. And the hadith goes on along the lines of these words, where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam is reported to have said that there is no angel who is close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nor is there a heaven or an earth or a mountain or a tree for that matter, except that it fears this occurrence on a Friday. On Friday, all of the creations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are in an apprehension, in a fear that the day of Qiyamah may take place on that day. Allahu Akbar. But we, on the other hand, myself included, we are so ignorant to the fact. We are ignorant of the virtue of Friday. And that is one of the reasons why I thought of basing today's khutbah on the virtue of the day Friday, and also in regard to some of the etiquettes prescribed for Fridays. Now let us move on to some of the etiquettes prescribed for Fridays. Number one, let's start off with Salatul Fajr. And I hope you all follow carefully, because these are very important etiquettes that we are supposed to bring into our lives in regard to Fridays. Number one, it starts off with Salatul Fajr on a Friday. The Imam is supposed to recite Suratul Sajda and Suratul Insan. هَلَا تَعَلَى الْإِنسَانِ حِينٌ مِّنَ الدَّهْرِ. These two surahs for Salatul Fajr. Completely, both of the two surahs, because it is from the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Hadith is in Bayhaqi. Ibn Umar radiyallahu anhu narrates that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said that the best prayer, look at this hadith, amazing hadith, the best prayer before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Fajr prayer on Friday with the jama'ah, with the congregation. The best prayer is on Friday and it is Fajr prayer with the Imam Jama'ah. This hadith is in Bayhaqi, narrated by Ibn Umar radiallahu an, and it is class Sahih by Imam Al-Albani rahimahullah. So we start off with Salatul Fajr. The Imam is supposed to recite these two surahs, and it is upon us to try and make it to the masjid. Many of us find it so difficult to lift the blanket and head to the masjid. It is because of the influence of the devil upon our hearts. Our hearts have hardened that there is no desire. On the other hand, if we have to go pick up someone from the airport, or else if we have to head over, perhaps if you're a doctor and if you're on call, you know duty calls and you have to head off to work, you are ready to wake up. But on the other hand, if it is to go to the masjid and stand in front of your beloved maker, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we find it so difficult. It is because of the influence of the devil upon our hearts. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all. So the second etiquette or sunnah from the sunnahs of the day of Friday is to take a bath on Friday. It is to take a bath on Friday. Hadith is recorded. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, إِذَا جَاءَ أَحَدُكُمُ الْجُمْعَةِ فَلْيَغْتَسِلْ. That when Friday comes, it is upon you to take a bath. It is upon us to take a bath on Friday before we head to the masjid. And if we look at the books of fiqh, for that matter, we would study that generally Islam encourages before any congregational gathering that we are supposed to take a bath. Say before we head to Salatul Jum'ah, we are supposed to take a bath. Before Salatul Eid, we are supposed to take a bath. Before Salatul Istisqa, we are supposed to take a bath. And the reason being, scholars write, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, that we are supposed to take a bath so that we do not harm the brother next to us with our offensive smells. In other words, our bad odor that comes from our body or our bodies. So we are supposed to take a bath and come pleasant using good fragrances like itr and perfumes, etc., and head to the masjid to involve ourselves in Salatul Jum'ah. The third etiquette that has been mentioned is to recite Suratul Kahf. Is to recite Suratul Kahf on Friday. Hadith is recorded where Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiyallahu anhu narrates that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, whoever reads Suratul Kahf on Friday, he will be illuminated with light. Allahu Akbar. Whoever reads Suratul Kahf on Friday, he will be illuminated with light between the two Fridays. In other words, from the Friday that he recited Suratul Kahf until the next Friday, he will be illuminated with light. Allahu Akbar. This hadith too has been classed Sahih by Imam Al-Albani in his book Sahih Al-Targhib. The next etiquette in regard to Fridays is that it is upon us to make excessive salawat upon our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allahumma salli ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad. And please remember salawat whenever I mention his beautiful name. It is upon us to make excessive salawat, especially on Friday, because there are narrations to state that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said along the lines of these words in regard to the virtue of Friday, that it is upon us to make salawat upon Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Excessive salawat. Sahaba ridwanullah ta'ala alayhim ajma'in, they asked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Rasulullah, how will you know? Because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was reported to have said that those salawat that you recite upon me will be shown to me. The Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi majma'in then asked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Rasulullah, how will the salawat be shown to you when your body would have turned to dust? In other words, after you die, your body will turn to dust. So how will you know about the salawat? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went on to say that in regard to the bodies of the Anbiya alayhi musallatu wasalam, the earth does not eat the bodies of the Anbiya alayhi musallatu wasalam. But now we must not misunderstand the hadith to state that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is alive. No. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is alive in the barzakh and not currently. He passed away. He passed away. As we very well know what happened after the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Umar radiallahu anhu was furious because he loved Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam so much. He could not accept that Rasulullah sallallahu, in other words, the rumors that were going around that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has passed away. He even threatened to chop off the neck of the one who says that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had passed away. Then what did Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu do? He comes out and he says, he calms the Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in by saying, those of you who believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, know that Allah the Almighty is eternal and He is ever living. But as for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, He has passed away. But the hadith talks about the earth eating their bodies or not. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam clarifies that the earth does not eat the bodies of the Anbiya alayhi salatu wa salam. And also the hadith states that it is upon us to make excessive salawat upon Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now the next etiquette is something very important, and that is in regard to going early to the masjid. Now this is something many of us fail to do these days. Going early to the masjid. Look at this hadith. Hadith is in Bukhari. And I hope this hadith instills in our hearts the desire to go early to the masjid on Fridays. Hadith is in Bukhari. Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu narrates that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said along the lines of these words, that whoever comes to the masjid on Friday, whoever comes to the masjid on Friday in the first hour, I will explain as we go. In the first hour, it is as if he sacrificed a camel. He gets the reward of sacrificing a camel. The one who comes in the first hour. And the one who comes in the second hour, it is as if he sacrificed a cow. And the one who comes in the third hour, it is as if he sacrificed a horned ram. And the one who comes in the fourth hour, it is as if he sacrificed a chicken. And the one who comes in the fifth hour, it is as if he gave, in other words, he gave an egg for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One tiny egg, the one who comes in the fifth hour. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went on to say, and when the imam comes out, when the khatib comes out, the malaika who are recording the people who are coming to the masjid in their registers, the minute the imam comes out, they close those registers and they too come into the masjid to listen to the reminder given by the imam. Allahu Akbar. Now in regard to these ayahs, scholars explain as to how do you categorize these ayahs. And the most favorable of opinions is that the time begins, in other words, the countdown begins, the competition begins right after sunrise. Allahu Akbar. Right after sunrise. From sunrise. Now say the sun rises at what? 5:55 a.m. So keep it at 6 o'clock a.m. From 6 till zenith, till the sun reaches the zenith, you divide that time into 5 portions. You divide that time into 5 portions and each portion has the reward. You come at the first portion, you get the reward of sacrificing a camel. Allahu Akbar. And if you were to come to the masjid close to the zenith, all you get is an egg. And if you were to come after the imam comes out, there is basically no reward for you. Allahu Akbar. Many of us, we tend to give importance to our work. We tend to give importance to our trade. We tend to give importance to other things other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The ayah I recited in the beginning, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, O you who believe, Iza nudiya li salati min yawmi al-jum'ah. If when the adhan is called out for the day, for Friday, in other words, for the day of Jum'ah, Fas'au ila dhikrillah. Rush towards the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not just walk, fas'au. Rush, run towards the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wadharul bay'a. And leave trade. leave your work, leave your business, leave everything and rush to the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. ذَلِكُمْ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. And that is what is best for you, إِن كُنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ, if you only knew. Allahu Akbar. Many of us have lost this importance for Friday, for Salatul Jum'ah, where we think that if we make it at the last minute, just before the Imam gets down from the minbar, it is enough. And then let me make my 2 rakat, it's much more easier, mashallah. If not, I have to pray 4 rakat of Salatul Dhuhr. On Friday, it's just 2 rakat and then I head out again. Allahu Akbar. No. The time begins right after sunrise. Right after sunrise, you divide it into 5 portions. And if you want to get the reward of sacrificing a camel, just see how early you need to be in the masjid. You need to be in the masjid, involving yourself in the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, involving yourself in praying optional salawat, involving yourself in making excessive salawat on Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, involving yourself in reciting Suratul Kahf and preparing for Salatul Jum'ah. The next etiquette in regard to Fridays, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, is to keep quiet and listen attentively to what the Imam says on Friday. Not to keep quiet and have a good nap. Many people think, let's keep quiet and have a good nap, mashallah, that's a power nap. I get back to work fully refreshed. On Fridays, I get a power nap of 20 to 25 minutes. No, that's not what the hadith or the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam teaches us. We are supposed to keep quiet and listen attentively to what the Imam says. And mashallah, in Kalambo, the Muaddin, just before the Imam climbs up, he gives a hadith. He informs the congregation, the hadith which is in Bukhari and Muslim, that even if you were to look at your companion who is next to you, whilst perhaps he is talking or maybe checking his newsfeed on Facebook, this is what we hear that the youngsters do on Fridays when they are up in the masjid. Even if you were to tell your companion, keep quiet or put your phone inside or listen to the Imam, you who are instructing your companion, you also have involved in vain speech. فَقَدْ لَغَوْتْ. You also have involved in vain speech. So it is upon us to keep quiet, to come early to the masjid, prepare ourselves for Salatul Jum'ah, not come at the last minute, to prepare ourselves for Salatul Jum'ah. All of this brings in khushu', humility and submissiveness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it is upon us to listen attentively to what the Imam is saying, so that we can benefit from the sermon, bring it into our lives. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all. Finally, we wrap off with the sunnah prayers. Before and after Salatul Jum'ah. Now this is something that many people are not aware of. In regard to the sunnah prayers that have been prescribed before Salatul Jum'ah, there aren't any sunnah prayers prescribed before Salatul Jum'ah. The sunnah of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam teaches us that on Fridays, what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to do was, right after the muadhin calls out the adhan, he used to climb up the minbar, the pulpit, and start off the sermon. So there aren't any sunnah prayers before Salatul Jum'ah. If you come to the masjid early, you can make your tahiyyatul masjid. You can make your tahiyyatul masjid. And you can pray however many optional nafil prayers you want to. But right after the adhan, this is only for Fridays. This is only for Fridays. Especially for Fridays, because we're talking about Fridays. After the adhan, there isn't any sunnah prescribed to be prayed after the adhan. But rather, there is sunnah after Salatul Jum'ah. After Salatul Jum'ah, what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would do was that he would go home. Now his home wasn't miles away from the masjid. His home was something similar to the room next to the masjid. He would enter his home and he used to pray 2 rakat of sunnah prayers after Salatul Jum'ah. The Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi majma'in were instructed by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to pray 4 rakat of sunnah prayers after Salatul Jum'ah. So scholars like Shaykhul Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, they explain that if you pray If you pray your sunnah prayers in the masjid, you're supposed to pray 4 raka'at after Salatul Jum'ah. But if you plan on going home and praying your sunnah prayers, then you stick to 2 sunnah raka'at, just like how Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did. But as for the sunnah prayers before Salatul Jum'ah, we have many brothers, right after the muadhin calls out the adhan, all the whole congregation gets up to pray 2 raka'at of sunnah prayers. This has not been prescribed through the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. On the other hand, when you enter the masjid, you can pray your tahiyyatul masjid, and then you can pray, say you come in the first portion from the 5 times we gave, so you have mashallah 4 to 5 hours remaining for Salatul Jum'ah. You can pray any amount of nafil prayers, optional prayers for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But right after the adhan on Friday, there aren't any sunnah prayers to be prayed before Salatul Jum'ah. This is from the etiquettes of Friday, something that many people are not aware of, and it is us du'at, us, we scholars, are to be blamed for not educating the masses. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive our shortcomings, and may Allah the Almighty forgive all of our sins, and may He accept our good deeds. May He unite all of us, just as how He united us here with our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the gardens of Jannah.